Hello everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Tracking Network Trends for 2021 and Beyond. My name is John Feld, and I'll be your moderator. Now, I'd like to introduce today's panelists. Courtney Monroe is Research Vice President, Worldwide Telecommunications Research at IDC, and Robert Victor is Senior Vice President of Product Management at Comcast Business. On behalf of Comcast Business, I'd like to welcome everyone again to Tracking Network Trends for 2021 and Beyond. As we move forward into 2021, the one thing we can count on is the increased role that connectivity technology will play as businesses of all sizes lean in hard to digital-first models to help assure their longevity as the business landscape shifts and adapts. Wireless connectivity alone is poised for massive growth across a wide range of platforms and devices. For example, according to DCI data, the number of global mobile subscribers should grow from 10.4 billion in 2020 to some 14.5 billion by 2024 and encompasses the steady growth of 5G. Recovery from the economic and cultural disruptions and adjusting to more long-lasting changes in related social and business practices will dominate enterprise IT investment decisions and reshape priorities over the next 5 years and beyond. What were once future-looking technology roadmaps have greatly accelerated to become infrastructure and network plans requiring immediate implementation. Today, we'll explore the technology landscape for the business year ahead and beyond, covering the core network issues arising during the past year, current network development and technology adoption and investment going forward, and the keys to network optimization in the future. To quickly review, Bob, we know that connectivity and vastly distributed users were sort of the two core themes for 2020. How would you summarize the key network issues of the past year?
Thanks, John, and welcome, everyone. I would say the number one key network issue has been, how do you connect so many of your workers at home to the business network? I mean, that's kind of obvious. The second issue has been a continuing trend toward cloud-based applications and access and security to those cloud-based applications. The second trend of cloud-based applications very much supports home-based workers. That infrastructure was put in place prior to COVID. And we've seen that infrastructure really be pressure tested this past year. And finally, of course, all of this presumes quality internet access. Without that access, there's no network.
And I think it's worth noting that you use the word pressure tested. And it's kind of surprising that given the rapid uptick in users and needs for capacity, you know, things perform generally very well.
Yeah, I agree, and I think we'll talk about, you know, the network as we get into the conversations, but absolutely.
And Courtney, how would you nutshell the key network issues of 2020?
Yeah, thanks, John. Picking up from where Bob left off, I would say because of this huge acceleration to the cloud, where companies wanted to leverage the cloud for applications in the cloud, for accessing cloud partners and content, I think what we saw is this tremendous increase in demand for networking capacity, whether it was access to cloud providers and colo centers, whether it was just for remote access. And as Bob said, that led to this really dramatic uptake, which in many cases took place in days rather than weeks or months. So to me, that was one of the most dramatic aspects of the cloud. And the other thing was the dramatic uptake in collaboration apps. And I think we saw that. So you have this access to the cloud, but also you have this tremendous adoption and implementation of collaboration apps, which we have not quite seen before. So I think those are two of the key most important aspects, as well as what Bob mentioned in terms of the use of remote applications and the VPNs to access and provide remote access.
And one of the things you also stressed in earlier conversations was that security is not going to have a small role to play here now and moving forward, correct?
That's absolutely correct. You need security for remote workers, even much more so than we've had in the past. And when you're aggregating hundreds or thousands of remote workers, you need a lot more security, and you need security for the corporate applications that they're accessing. You know, we live in a zero trust world, and zero trust means you have security internally and you have security for external access. So security remains top of mind for CIOs and CTOs today.
And certainly we'll get into that a little bit more later on. So between the acceleration, security, and other needs, it has certainly been a challenging year. And Courtney, we've had plenty of surprises in 2020. What, in your mind, were some of the biggest, and were there also unintended benefits?
Well, to me, you know, it may not have been a surprise to me, but I think one of the biggest surprises is the resilience of the overall network infrastructure, right? In many cases, we saw spikes from 25% to 50% to 75% in network traffic, depending on the type of applications that were in use. And as Bob said, the network and the infrastructure held up. It performed as planned for, you know, these types of situations. So, I mean, while it wasn't surprising, it was good to see that the network held up and we had great performance and resiliency. And then secondly, I think what was great to see was this spike in use of collaboration apps, for example, video. But also to see that this will be sustained over the course of the next several years. I don't believe this is a temporary spike. I believe this is going to be a sustainable growth, because companies have realized that, look, we need to engage digitally with our customer base, and this is going to be an ongoing process for me.
Yeah, and at one point you also discussed the fact that there are specific verticals where we've really seen it taken off, such as healthcare and education. Can you expand on that a little bit?
I would say yes, healthcare, where we've seen the use of telehealth dramatically increase because you just can't visit your doctor. I think education, you know, kids have been at home for months, and we've had a crash course in Zoom. If you have kids, you understand what I'm talking about. But most importantly, I think we are going to see more and more applications, for example, around video, one-to-one applications for, one-to-one video. I think we're going to see video being used more for, say, field force workers, right? And then reporting, for example, insurance and financial cases where you may be in an accident and your insurance company will use a video application so that you can report back. So that is what I meant, that we're going to see a lot more sustainable, long-term dependence on the cloud and cloud-based applications going forward.
And Bob, from your perspective, what about some of the sort of biggest surprises that we saw?
You know, I would agree with both of you. I think comfort with video collaboration was a surprise. And we've had, you know, the idea of a picture phone has been around for a long, long time. And we've had a lot of this technology, but just the uptake with which it's been used and just how really companies are managing their business and, you know, substituting in-person meetings with video was just, you know, more seamless and happened faster and more quickly, I think, than anyone might have expected. I do think the biggest surprise, though, is, you know, as you said, that the internet didn't come to a screeching halt. You know, if you would have said, we're going to run a massive experiment, everyone in the country is going to work from home and do video conferencing today, and we'll just see what happens, just in case of emergency, I think we probably all would have said, you know, that's a good thing to do as a test. And I think we all would have learned a lot from doing that test. But you know, that's effectively what we did, and it wasn't a test. And I would say, by and large, Europe, you know, had some problems. And you know, the infrastructure and the internet in the U.S. as a broad network has just held up remarkably well. John, you had pointed earlier to some stats. I mean, here at Comcast, we're all incredibly proud of our network and our team supporting that network. Shortly after the COVID shutdowns occurred, we saw an increase of about 60% in peak traffic in some cities, in significant part driven by about a 200% increase in video conferencing, you know, right after the shutdown. Now, that traffic and that video conferencing use has only increased since the beginning.
And it seems to me that at this point, after that, what you termed a pressure test, we've come to this place where as Courtney says, it's sustainable. It is here to stay. If you look across verticals where customer engagement now, a lot of that will likely move online. So it seems that at coming out of this, we're in a very good position moving forward. Would you agree with that?
I would agree with that, although I think, you know, thinking back to the remote worker, it proceeded in somewhat of a haphazard and quick way. And so I think there are refinements on that model that will occur and that is occurring now that it's becoming more stable. But I think the big trend going forward, at least for the next few years, will be more of a hybrid model with some people coming back to work and others working remotely. And in that hybrid model or that hybrid environment, you've got to deal with the challenges of both a mobile workforce and a workforce where not everyone's in the office, but some are. And I suspect most companies will want to standardize how people are connecting remotely, particularly for security reasons and for quality of access purposes. And so, you know, by and large, it was done pretty well. But, you know, as it moves from test to BAU, there are lots of opportunities for standardization. Therefore, what we'll see as a result of that at workers' homes are more SD-WAN type applications, more standardized VPN security access, more remote desktops. And then conversely, in the office, I think there'll be a need to rethink conference rooms and collaboration tools to reflect this hybrid environment where we'll have some people working together and other people joining virtually.
It seems as almost as though we've had a redefinition of distributed workforce throughout this whole pandemic, and it's really sort of rebranded going forward as well. And Bob, now that we've seen at least some of the digital transformation plans and initiatives greatly accelerate, where do you see network development, infrastructure, and investment taking place? And how is that related to core priorities?
Yeah, no, as I think I said, it will be taking the infrastructure that exists in the office and extending it to the home. So, you know, SD-WAN type applications that will recognize someone's home as a node on the network, more standardized VPN security access, so that, you know, there's a need if people are working from home and accessing the internet from home. There's, from a business perspective, you've got to lock down all of the corporate traffic and the corporate infrastructure that's working for the business as opposed to someone's home use. And then remote desktops, you know, as you think about software and what exists at the customer site and on their PC, it's just much, much easier and much simpler to implement if everything is cloud-based. And so the infrastructure effectively exists not in someone's home, but in the cloud.
And you've also mentioned that we're going to see new SaaS-type applications and collaboration tools and even new hardware technology, so we have to be ready for that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we, you know, we wouldn't have imagined, you know, companies like Zoom would have taken off just so as quickly as they did. And, you know, those companies will continue to morph and do new things. Teams, everyone's using Teams. And I think as we move from a virtual environment to more of a hybrid model, you know, we'll see lots of opportunity for new applications and new tools and new types of hardware.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting that Zoom at one point was looked upon sort of as people who were more technology cognizant used it as their own sort of tool, and then between March and August of this year, new subscribers went up by 784%, which is pretty amazing. And Courtney, where do you see network development and infrastructure and investment taking place in 2021 and beyond?
Right. I think there's a few key areas. I think one, companies have to become much more agile in terms of implementing digital platforms. And it's not just about being digital, it's about what that brings and how it allows you to innovate and engage with customers in digital channels. And but we're also seeing from a network perspective that companies have had to basically come up with new ways of engaging with customers, engaging with suppliers. You know, we saw retail companies come up with curbside, deliveries, new point of sale applications, and a big investment in touchless technologies, right? But you also need a robust infrastructure to support, these new applications. You need a reliable Wi-Fi. You need a strong, more bandwidth to support these applications. And then you also need your business continuity plans, right? What if your fixed line, circuit is overloaded? You need to be able to switch to say an LTE or soon a 5G backup, right? And that's where SD-WAN comes in. And SD-WAN is not just about, hybrid and multiple access points. It's about security. It's about application optimizing. And that works for remote workers, as Bob said as well. So if you're at home and, your kid jumps on Netflix or they fire up a game, SD-WAN will know that, look, mom's video conferencing session is priority or her voice call is priority, and that will be allocated more bandwidth and better service quality. So I think with SD-WAN, that facilitates application optimization, hybrid access points, and there's a lot more we can talk about. We can talk about sort of secure and intelligent routing for call center agents who are all working remotely, right? So I think in terms of thinking about how the network will change and how we think about the network, these are just some of the ways that I think companies have to think more creatively going forward.
Mm-hmm. So in that sense, we're talking about infrastructure network. So Courtney, what sort of growth, adoption, and proliferation of technologies within that framework, such as high-capacity networks, SD-WAN, cloud, mm-hmm. and edge computing, and those related to remote workers, can we expect to see?
I think we're going to see, cloud is definitely going to continue to grow at double-digit rates, right? I think what will change, as Bob mentioned earlier, is the way we use cloud. It's going to be, it's not just about private cloud, public cloud. It's also going to be about implementing a private cloud instance on-prem. So depending on your privacy and compliance issues, whether you're a bank, whether you're a healthcare institution, you may need to keep, some information on-prem, but you also need to orchestrate that with a public cloud. So I think we're going to see more use of a private cloud instance that is orchestrated with public cloud. And you also need the bandwidth to support that, right? And you need the security. And I think that's where security remains important, as we'll see later from some of the survey data we've done. And then, we're living in a world where the edge is becoming much more important. So companies are looking to 5G, and we've begun to see those early applications leveraging 5G, and we expect to see tremendous growth in those applications going forward. Some of the stuff we've seen is, for example, leveraging 5G with AI for surgery. And I think that's one example, and that's going to be on a 5G infrastructure. And there's going to be many new applications emerging. So we expect to see strong growth for that. I talked a little bit earlier about accessing the cloud, and here is where we saw a tremendous growth in terms of, up to 10x the bandwidth required for accessing cloud connectivity and cloud providers. We saw some companies, go from 1 gig to 10 gig, some of the content providers to 100 gig in a space of days. And I expect that growth to continue, over the next couple of years. And then finally, leveraging digital platforms implementing APIs to leverage cloud applications. I think that is also where we're going to see tremendous growth in excess of 20 to 30% over the next few years. So these are just a few of the key areas where we expect to see tremendous investment and growth in emerging technologies.
And it's interesting to note that in the context of all this, in more cloud-based platforms, flexible and secure bandwidth, et cetera, through all these, I think the notion of reliability also runs as a thread, because there's an expectation that this is all going to work, and we've come to just sort of rely on that. Do you think that's part of this paradigm as well, is increased reliability or expected reliability?
Absolutely, and I think that's, you know, companies are going to take a hard look at business continuity and disaster recovery, right? So what do I have in place? You know, how many multi-home endpoints do I have for each site? And, you know, what is my backup circuit? And do I have enough surge capacity, you know, as well? So I think those are all issues that companies are going to look at, and they also want to have a service provider that can assure them of 999 or even 100% availability when you take into impact disaster recovery and business continuity. So I think that's absolutely important. Reliability is definitely key.
Excellent. And Bob, would you do us a favor and just take us and drill down into the technologies a bit and where you think the growth and investment will be?
Sure. First and foremost, you know, I think you've got to start with with bandwidth. You know, there has been and will really continue to be a growth in bandwidth. You know, as you kind of look back and you see, you know, bandwidth growing 20 or 30% a year, it's easy to say, well, look, you know, there's probably only so much, you know, that bandwidth can continue to grow. But as we think about all of these technologies and the ability to collaborate, the importance of video, the accessing applications to the cloud, the upload and download, you know, that whole environment is going to continue to drive a lot more bandwidth growth. Beyond that, I would point to a couple other areas. You said drill down on some of the technologies. So we talked a little bit about SD-WAN. Courtney mentioned that as well. I think we're moving beyond the early adopter phase to become generally accepted. As Courtney mentioned, you know, SD-WAN allows you to control what applications get what priority, what applications are secured. If a primary circuit goes down, you can seamlessly fail over to a second circuit. And that technology has been put in place in many companies with multi-sites, and it's, you know, it's quickly being put in place with it's being quickly put in place to almost all businesses, you know, that have, you know, five or more sites. And, you know, for us at Comcast, we see that as just a great opportunity and a place that, you know, we've really positioned ourselves to serve as a leader as companies transition from more legacy networking technologies like ATM or frame relay to next generation SD-WAN IP-based connectivity. It really fits very well with what we do. Courtney mentioned this as well. Cloud and edge is also a critical investment area. I would say that there's been a movement to cloud for a long time. You know, in AWS, Microsoft Azure, Google Cloud are enormous behemoths at this point. This is not new technology at all. This is really fundamentally established technologies. And most large companies have moved their workflows into the cloud, and so have next generation productivity tool providers. So Microsoft Office is operated in the cloud. You know, it used to be operated on your desktop. And nearly all companies now are working with cloud providers. And so cloud is an ongoing trend also that's going to continue to accelerate. Edge computing is a bit newer and in some ways is also back to the future. People have desktop computers and laptops that are really edge or premise compute. But the difference now is instead of going to workflows in the cloud, for latency reasons, sometimes there's a need to move that compute from the cloud to the edge. And what's especially driving a lot of this is 5G networks. The way 5G networks are built requires edge compute given the latency requirements of tracking devices on those networks. And so all of the mobile network operators are working, are driving the cloud hyperscalers into the edge, and there's big movement there. And so the hope is as companies develop private LTE and private 5G networks, that because they've deployed that edge compute for those networks, they'll be able to use that edge compute for other very low latency applications. And so I would say for independent reasons, you have bandwidth, software-defined networking, cloud, edge compute, and 5G all growing. But when you put all those technologies together and you look at the impact of the growth on each of them combined, a flywheel results. And so the more you're using cloud assets and cloud compute, the more the need there is for bandwidth. SD-WAN provides a way to manage a network of locations at much lower cost with better visibility and granularity to the data being transferred across those different locations. And as a result, you know, there's a need for more high-capacity network to connect all those locations. And that, in turn, also enables companies to use more cloud assets, you know, efficiently and effectively. So those are some of the key network technologies that I see, you know, really growing as a result of what we've seen in the past year.
And I assume that, you know, throughout all this, mobile is also somewhat, if not as important, certainly plays a great role in terms of, you know, capacity for Wi-Fi and Wi-Fi 6, 5G, et cetera. Would you say that's the case?
Yeah, I'd say it's the case, but I would break down mobile into two different things. I think when you think about being in an office or being in a home, you basically just want, you know, like you've got electric outlets in every room, you want internet connectivity in every room, and you just want that to be in the air. You don't want to have to actually plug in like you do for electricity to access the internet. And so there's a huge need in any location where there are people just to provide internet connectivity. And you know, most of that historically has been done through Wi-Fi, and that will continue, and Wi-Fi will become better and better. It will also get done through private LTE networks. So taking the macro network that you think about outside, and you think about connecting to your wireless device or your mobile phone, and just putting that inside and making that seamless. On the outside, you know, more and more devices, smart cars, in the Internet of Things, different types of applications are also going to connect to the internet, and for that you really need a macro network. So I see growth in both in the macro network likes of AT&T, Verizon, T-Mobile, as well as growth in, you know, in Wi-Fi and really unlicensed network access.
Okay, thanks for breaking that down, Bob. And you know, we certainly discussed a number of technologies. So, Courtney, of those, is there any particular way to prioritize those, or which of them might have the biggest impact in the short and long term?
Yeah, I think Bob did a good job of talking about, you know, some of the impending changes we're seeing from the use of mobile and 5G that's going to be upcoming. I think there's a couple of areas I see, which is we haven't really talked about is how do you use analytics? How do you use AI? And I think that is going to be important as we continue to leverage remote access and VPNs, and you need security, and also you need intelligent routing. I mentioned before that, you know, with remote agents, you know, you need AI to figure out, you know, who's the best agent to answer a specific question, but also how to optimize the network, right? What's the best route for a call to traverse over the network? And same for data. How do we optimize data routing so that there's just one hop to the destination or the data center of choice? So I see as we go to these new forms of communicating by remote access with secure VPNs, I think how we use data and how we manage that data, especially as we go to, you know, processing more and more and huge amounts of data on the edge, and also with new IoT type applications, where you don't want to send everything back to a centralized data center. You want to have the ability to intelligently process that data on the edge of the network. But as Bob said, you also need a lot of bandwidth on that edge, and that is crucial as well for exchanging a lot of data. So I think as we use more data, as we change the way we analyze data, I think that's going to have a significant impact. And as we use data to analyze and make the network more secure, I think the network is going to be increasingly important.
So as opposed to prioritizing any of those technologies, it seems more like they have to work effectively in concert to truly optimize the network. Is that sort of an accurate way to put it?
Absolutely. You have to be smart. You have to have a sort of intelligent optimization, and you have to have automation of the network, right? And we've seen the operators increasingly spend a lot of time and money and energy figuring out how to automate the network so that, you know, it can be predictive. You don't need a human intervention in case of emergencies. And the network just becoming a lot more smarter. I think that is something that you've hit the nail on the head there.
We talked earlier sort of about the importance of security. And how is it related to the current acceleration in digital transitions, Courtney?
Well, I think I see security remaining top of mind. I mean, this has been the case, for the last decade or so. But as we move more towards a geographically distributed points of presence with smaller remote sites, say leveraging SD-WAN, with remote workers in scattered across the country and even across the globe, I think you need security to orchestrate and manage, you know, intrusion detection, threat detection, DDoS attacks. I think that's, you know, with more points, endpoints, you have a higher degree, a higher risk factor, and security becomes a lot more paramount. And then as you operate in a hybrid infrastructure where, you have a private cloud, a VNS on-prem, on cloud, at remote sites, I think you need orchestration among all of those sites. And that's where I think security is also paramount. And I think that's why you're seeing this importance of how do I implement hybrid cloud and what do I need in terms of my configuration for the cloud? How much of it should be public? How much of it should be private? And then how do I orchestrate? What are my network and bandwidth needs? Where do I put this processing? Is it, you know, in a data center, my data center? Is it in a third-party colocation data center? So I think these are all the factors that companies are looking at and thinking about as we move, you know, to what is sort of the new normal.
And certainly with greater distribution, all of those points become a little bit more complex. And in addition, greater distribution means greater potential access to anybody looking to get into the network that shouldn't be there.
Absolutely.
And Bob, as we go forward, what kind of advice or guidance might you offer for those looking to optimize network and infrastructure technology in these sort of continuing uncertain times? What kind of lessons do you think we can apply from the past year to planning going forward?
John, by and large, the IT community and the networking community, both the vendors and company, you know, and businesses using those products has held up incredibly well. I think CEOs, management, and the rank and file have looked at their IT staff and IT partners and have really been incredibly appreciative. The investments that a lot of those companies made in VPN technology and laptops and cloud computers and security have served those companies extraordinarily well during the crisis. And companies didn't put those in place anticipating COVID, but for sure there's been a trend to IP connectivity and more simple networks, more cloud-based computing, more work from anywhere, work from home. And those platform investments have been very, very helpful. Now that the grand experiment's played out, you know, companies and IT professionals are picking their heads up and saying, look, this is the new normal. What are our gaps? How do we firm up what we have? How do we plug certain security risks that we see that Courtney talked about? But there's been a little bit more calm because that rush to make sure that everyone's connected and to make sure the infrastructure works in this environment has passed. And now companies are looking back and appreciating those investments. So there's just a lot of credibility the networking IT staff have earned through their ability to put in place and really harden the platforms and harden the capabilities that their companies have. Now, you know, now there's an opportunity to leverage and optimize those investments and really make that technology work even better. And now we can look at what's missing. This has worked better than we ever would have thought. And this is 80% of what we need. So let's take a look at the other 20%. You know, what are we missing? What would help us become even more productive?
It is remarkable that the technology roadmaps that most of us were using were suddenly accelerated beyond what anybody expected. And as you say, Bob, you know, so much of it actually turned out to be right. And it seems as though what you're also saying is now going forward, we have the opportunity to really stop, take a breath, look at what's working and what hasn't been working, and move to even greater optimization. Is that a good characterization?
Yeah, that is. I would also say that there's not going to be a turn back to pre-COVID. You know, COVID's over. We're all going to go back to work and work like we all used to. You know, I think as I've been saying, there's going to be a sense of, you know, some of this was really terrific, and some of us, you know, don't want to work from home all the time, but, you know, working from home a couple of days isn't bad, or working from a different location isn't bad, or, you know, there are, but when that happens, I think all of us would say, look, if some people are working from home and some people are in the office, we got to figure out how to collaborate even better, because we've missed getting together in person with a lot of our colleagues and partners and really hashing things out. And, you know, you begin to see new whiteboarding technologies, new applications that facilitate that type of environment. So I'm super optimistic about the path forward, and I'm excited also for our customers and the credibility that they can bring to their organizations given what they've done.
And Courtney, what about your sort of guidance or advice going forward?
Well, you know, I think what we've seen is, you know, over the last 6 or 7 months, we've seen companies, if you look at this slide, move gradually and steadily from left to right. You know, initially it was all about implementing business continuity measures, you know, providing the hardware and access to the applications and the bandit capabilities for employees who are working remote and beefing up and scaling up resources for different sites. And then as companies progressed, I think, you know, they've realized, look, we have to have more cloud-based resources and more cloud-based assets. And we've also have to figure out how to engage with our suppliers, our partners, and our customers on a digital, you know, basis. So we're seeing companies implement more cloud-based communications, whether it's CRM or ERP type apps or notification apps or providing notifications to customers for deliveries, for chatbots or omni-channel conversations. We've seen companies, you know, steadily but surely adopt these new technologies. And I think that the last phase is going to be, what have we learned over the course of this year? And how do we prepare for the future by you know, sustaining this movement and putting lessons learned into continuity and resource bandwidth and et cetera. And I think that's where this is going to become permanent, and we're going to see companies now instituting these and being ready for the future, and then incorporating some of these new technologies that we talked about, 5G and more and specific cloud instances. I think that's the lessons learned over the last 8 to 9 months.
Yeah, and as you say, I think we should expect this to be sustainable, and that much of what we learned will certainly be put into practice as we move forward. Well, thank you, Courtney and Bob. Great conversation. We have some questions from the audience that I'd like to tackle. And the first one for Courtney, how do you see satellite internet or similar services meeting the need of connecting rural locations that are difficult to connect to broadband given the capital costs?
I see satellite playing an important role, but I think the there's still latency issues with satellite. So, you know, while I think it's important, I think what's more important is perhaps implementing 5G, because I think that's probably a lot more cost effective, and you can get a lot more bandwidth than you'll get with satellite. So I see satellite as being an important option, but I still think that it doesn't provide the most optimal latency that you can get with, say, 5G or wired infrastructure.
Mm-hmm. And Bob, do you see the unit cost of broadband services going down given the massive increase in use, and would you expect bandwidth caps growing to meet the need at a lower cost? And the question is for both commercial and work-at-home residential.
So I would say yes, definitely to the first, and you know, no, definitely to the second, which is, you know, the growth in bandwidth, you know, our unit cost right now to deliver a bit, you know, is a, you know, a fraction of what it was even just a few years ago. You know, when you have effectively bandwidth compounding at a 30 to 50% growth rate, and price, you know, going up at most, you know, really low single digits, you're seeing massive drops in cost per bandwidth. And I very much expect that to continue. Companies have a limited budget, and people have a limited budget to spend on bandwidth. And, you know, given the competition among different bandwidth providers, and I agree with Courtney, 5G is probably more interesting than satellite, although satellite will have a role. You know, we'll see continued competition to provide that broadband. And then on caps, you know, I would say, look, if you're selling any product, the last thing that you'd want to do is cap your sales of that product. You know, we at Comcast, you know, are delighted that customers are using more and more bandwidth, and that's really core to the growth of our business. You know, I think as customers use more and more bandwidth, it puts, you know, a real premium on having a wired connection over, you know, a wireless connection, but there'll be opportunities for both. And in fact, most people will end up having both. And as Courtney mentioned, I think customers really will require 100% reliability. And inevitably, in a wired infrastructure, you'll have occasions where it will just be a fiber cut. And so, you know, some customers, even if wireless may not be quite as good, would certainly want to fail over to a wireless network and use wireline as primary. So, you know, I see a lot of growth in the delivery of bandwidth over, you know, the near to mid to long-term time horizon.
And another question for Bob. Bob, you noted that the Comcast network was in a good position to handle the rapid large traffic changes that we recently all underwent. Why is that? What about it made Comcast ready for that shift in capacity? What sort of preparations did you take?
Well, we really engineer our networks at the peak bandwidth, and we typically historically have seen peak bandwidth, you know, during the prime time hours when a lot of people are on television watching TV. And so, you know, as people work from home more and more, you know, that really just smoothed out the curve. We saw a lot more usage during those hours. And then at home, as people are more at home more and not going out more, they're not only watching more television or streaming video, they're using the internet. And it's, you know, we have very simple paths to upgrade the capacity of our network. I mean, I say simple, it's not actually so simple when you go to implement it, but we've got great visibility into usage across the network and just a tremendous technology organization that, you know, has worked really 24/7 over the crisis to continually upgrade the network wherever we've been seeing shortages.
Courtney, you said that the expanded use of collaboration apps is sustainable. Why is that? What makes it so?
Well, I believe because there is a comfort level now with using video. I mean, I'll tell you, a year ago, my doctor said he would never do, you know, he would never go digital. And today, I think we are, you know, my visits this year has been largely, you know, by video. So I believe that is going to be sustainable. And I think as we go along and you know, people become much more comfortable you know, leveraging digital interactions, say, for appointments, for notifications, and video conferencing. I think that that's what I meant by it's going to be sustainable. You know, and all of the carriers will tell you, a lot of the, even the specialist video conferencing platforms have seen, you know, 300-500% growth. Now, we're not going to see that on a sustainable basis, but I think we're going to see strong double-digit growth over the next couple of years, because I think that we're going to see new and more innovative ways for digital interaction that just not broadcast, but one-to-one. And to me, that's the important growth factor we're going to see, is that one-to-one interaction on a professional basis.
Continued innovation brings that about.
Absolutely.
And Bob, how can SD-WAN apps work in a home environment?
Really the same way they would work in a multi-location environment. But actually, and Courtney referred to this, there's really two ways to kind of think about SD-WAN working in a home environment. You know, the first is homes have residential internet, and you can run SD-WAN on top of that residential internet. And the SD-WAN can say, as Courtney mentioned earlier in his discussion, look, if it's a critical video conference to work, we're going to give priority to that, you know, application over the streaming video application. And, you know, it will just work on the existing, you know, your existing internet and prioritize traffic that way. It can also, in the home, you could connect your mobile network connection to it. So if you've got a problem with the wired connection, it could fail over to mobile. So that's one way. The second way, which I think is particularly interesting for executives, for doctors, for people for whom bandwidth is just critical, is to really have a separate, and for families whose kids say, look, no, I don't want my streaming apps compromised if mom or dad is working from home, and I certainly don't want any more latency on my gaming applications. And that the way that it could work there is you just get a second modem or a second internet connection to the house that rides on SD-WAN. That entire link is dedicated to, you know, a home's business use. Presumably the business would pay for that use, and then the residents would continue to enjoy the home internet they're getting from their internet provider today, and you wouldn't see any additional traffic on that link as a result of business. So really in those two ways.
Mm-hmm. And Courtney, you used healthcare and telehealth such as video diagnosis as examples of technology growth and adoption. How do you see it working across other verticals? Any examples you can offer?
Sure. I think that I see it working in retail for support and field service support. I see it working in the financial sector, where you may want to have an interaction with a investment or banking specialist. I see in the future, for example, banks implementing video kiosks at their branches, where, you know, you may want information on a specific, you know, banking question. So, you know, instead of a live person, you can either do an interactive video, or you can do a streamed video session. So, you know, those are examples that I see. I also see us using more augmented reality. So we're seeing, for example, training with you know, holograms, and I think those are ways that, you know, we're going to see video implemented, in different areas. You need bandwidth to do that. You need specific edge configuration technologies to do that, whether it's CDNs or caching. So there's a lot that needs to be done as well on the edge.
And since you bring that up, Bob, a final question for you. Why does the way 5G networks are built require edge computing? It's something that you had discussed earlier.
Because if you think about the number of devices that are interacting with a radio in a certain area, the computer has to, or the networks have to track exactly where those devices are, to update the status of them, to make sure they're secure, to manage handoffs between towers, to prioritize applications going there. And so you don't have time to send the signal from the local cell tower into the cloud. You know, there, so you need to actually do the computing and processing, you know, closer to the end device. And so typically the edge compute is serving, you know, a call it 3 to 5 towers or a small geographic region. But it's really all about latency. It just, you don't have time to move the time it takes for the light to travel from a device through 2 hops to the cloud and then back to the device is insufficient for some of the 5G applications we're seeing.
Courtney, thank you very much for joining us today. We appreciate your expertise.
Absolutely. I really enjoyed the session today, and I hope our audience finds it insightful.
Yes, and Bob, thanks for your contributions as well. Really enjoyed the conversation.
Thanks, John. No, I appreciated the conversation. Thanks, Courtney, for joining, and thanks, everyone, for tuning in. And if there's a way that Comcast Business can be helpful, please click on the link on the presentation screen.
Thank you, Bob, and thanks to all of you out there. On behalf of us at Comcast Business, have a great rest of your day.